Hello, I'm James Rippey. This lecture is on how to perform an ultrasound examination. It doesn't matter what area of ultrasound you're looking at, whether you're looking at someone's eyeball or their testicle or an early pregnancy examination or their heart in a cardiac arrest or their gallbladder, the principles are the same. And this lecture is all about how to do an ultrasound examination, it doesn't matter what of. And hopefully you'll be able to apply it to whatever module of ultrasound you're learning. I think it's a very important lecture. I hope you enjoy it. The lecture is divided into four parts. The first is preparation and getting everything ready before you start the scan. We go through the patient, the machine, and the environment. The next section of the lecture is on using the machine and optimizing the image and recording your images. We then get onto the nitty-gritty of actually using the transducer, how to get the best image and how to explore an organ, and finally completing the scan with writing a report and how to look after the ultrasound machine. So let's go to the beginning and talk about preparation. The first thing is preparing the patient. Obviously you adapt your explanation to the patient to the clinical scenario. You're not going to spend hours telling a patient in cardiac arrest about your ultrasound, but generally I try and explain the aim of the ultrasound to a patient and tell them that my ultrasound in emergency medicine is a focused scan. It doesn't look for everything, it's just looking for one or two things. I also explain the limitations of ultrasound in my hands and what my level of expertise is. It's really important they understand. You can imagine if you do a limited trauma ultrasound, a fast scan on a patient, and they go and tell their GP that they've had an abdominal ultrasound that was all normal, the communication is all wrong. All you've looked for is free fluid. You haven't looked for gallstones, you haven't looked for all those other important things that a complete abdominal ultrasound would look for. So the patients need to understand what we're doing, as do our fellow colleagues. I also explain to patients what ultrasound involves. It involves putting on cold gel, unless you're lucky enough to have a gel warmer. I tell them I'm going to press with the ultrasound probe on their tummy and that they should tell me if it hurts, because it generally shouldn't do. Getting the patient in the right position is very important, and preparing them is also important. In the real world of emergency medicine, we can't really fast patients for biliary scans and aortic scans, but if you can, it's nice. Similarly, an early pregnancy scan is much better transabdominally through a full bladder, so if you can get the patient to fill their bladder, that's great. The position, we vary according to the clinical scenario and according to the type of scan or procedure. So with a fast or limited trauma scan, we have the patient, or the patient has to be managed supine, often with a neck collar on, and usually in a resuscitation area with a huge team around you, but this is the patient position. For a renal scan though, we often want to open up the patient's ribs, and having them lying on their side and with the arm above them opens up the rib cage here, and you get a better intercostal view of the kidney. For a biliary scan, having the patient on their side will often make the gallbladder fall out from underneath the costal margin. You'll get much better images that way. For procedural ultrasound and an internal jugular line, putting the patient head down is important. 10 degrees head down will increase the size of the internal jugular vein significantly and make the whole procedure much more easy. Here I'm looking for pleural fluid. With the patient sitting up, the pleural fluid will be dependent within the thoracic cage. And again, optimal position depends on what you're looking for. Here looking at an Achilles. Here I'm looking at the brachial plexus and around the axillary artery for an axillary approach brachial plexus block, which is what I often use for Colles fractures. The next step is the machine. Now, traditionally the machine is placed on the patient's right. You stand as if you're examining the patient. You use the right hand to control the transducer and the left hand to control the machine. So it's essentially the position that you're in when we examine a patient. Procedural ultrasound is a bit different. It's really important that you line everything up. So in this case, we've got me looking, the probe in between me and the screen. So everything's lined up, me, patient and probe, and machine. I compare it to driving a car. Imagine if you're driving a car, you sitting in the seat, the steering wheel in front of you and the road in front of that. Imagine trying to drive a car if the steering wheel was where the gear stick is and it wasn't all lined up. Things would be much, much more difficult. Now you're trying to drive a needle into that patient. Everything's got to be lined up. So here I am. This is the position I use for putting an internal jugular line. Again, me, probe and patient, machine. For that nerve block, me, probe and patient, machine. All lined up. It's also important we prepare the environment. And again, that needs to be adapted to the clinical setting. Obviously, if you're flying a helicopter or doing a flying doctor retrieval, you're not going to be able to turn the noise down and dim the lights. But ideally, dimming the lights makes a big difference and optimizes the ultrasound image. It's nice to have the bed at the right height. Again, interrupting a resuscitation to raise the bed might not be appropriate. But people who do lots of ultrasound get sore backs and sore wrists and shoulders. So try and get things as comfortable as possible. If you're doing procedural ultrasound, it's really important that you set up any equipment that you might need before you're all scrubbed and in action. Make sure you've got a sterile transducer cover and a chair and everything is organized. And here I am popping in a PIC line. Again, notice my position, the probe covered, all the equipment easily attainable just on a sterile trolley to my right and the machine at the other side, all in a row, machine, patient and probe, and me. Okay, the next section is using the machine. There are lots of different machines on the market. This one on the left is a small and very sturdy, reliable machine, which is simple. The aim is to make it transportable, small, simple, and tough, and versatile, and in fact it is. This machine in the middle is far more complex, and it can achieve different and better quality images in some cases, and you can manipulate the image more finely, and depending on what you're looking at, it might be much more appropriate for you. But if you're in a helicopter or a busy emergency room, it may not. It depends on what sort of ultrasound you're doing. This machine on the right has more buttons, and you can adjust. It's a small machine. It's somewhere between in terms of complexity, between the simple one on the left and the more complex one in the middle. But really, when you're choosing a machine, they all have similar principles. And each has its own benefit. And it really depends on what you're going to be using your machine for as to which one you get. The nice thing is that using them, the principles are the same. When I'm using the machine and trying to optimize an image, I use a silly little mnemonic, or it's not even a mnemonic, but a PPPDFG. And that is prepare the patient, the probe, and the preset, and then change the depth, the frequency on focus and gain. And I get those printed out and actually stick them on the ultrasound machine for people who are beginning their training. So they always remember whenever they're doing an ultrasound, patient, probe, preset, depth, frequency, focus, and gain. Let's go through that. The first thing you need to do is enter the patient details, P for patient. These machines usually have a button that says patient. Here is one of those machines with a patient button. You can put in whatever details you want. I tend to put in the name, the unit number, why I'm doing the scan, and who I am. Our bigger machine has a patient button. And remember, patient, probe, preset, patient, probe, preset. Very convenient. And again, name, unit number, indication, and who I am, so I can look up my scans later on. When you press the patient button, a screen that looks rather like this comes up. You can enter whatever details you want, as I said, the patient's name, their ID number, their date of birth, their gender if you want to, why you're doing the scan, where you're from. Enter as much as you want. I'm fairly minimalist and I know in the emergency setting we're in a hurry, so I tend to just enter the patient's name, unit number, and my details. The next thing you need to do is choose the probe, so PPP, patient probe preset. Now the probe or transducer. There are many different sorts of probes, and these are the three from those three machines that I showed you at the beginning, but these are similar probes. They're called linear arrays, and they're high-frequency probes. That means they run at a range of ultrasound frequencies that are of a higher frequency, generally about 7 to 15 megahertz. Now, high frequency means high resolution, which means you get a really good, fine, detailed picture. But it also means you can't look very far into a patient. So high frequency, high resolution, good picture, but superficial depth. You can only look in a short way. And we tend to use this probe for looking at blood vessels and vascular access, or small parts like musculoskeletal ultrasound or testicular ultrasound, and for nerves and nerve blocks. The curvilinear array probe, or the abdominal probe, here they are again from those three machines sitting next to each other. And the picture that you get on the ultrasound machine is this type of picture, as opposed to the more rectangular picture. You get a piece of pie picture with a curvilinear array. Now, these operate at a much lower frequency, which means they have give a picture of lower resolution. They tend to range between about 2 and 5 megahertz. So lower resolution means the picture looks a bit grainier than those high frequency probes, but you can actually see in further. You can look in at a greater depth. And we tend to use these probes for abdominal imaging and pelvic imaging and obstetric imaging. The next sort of probe is the phased array or cardiac probe. The nice thing about that is that it's got a very small footprint, and the footprint is the name that we use for this little bit of the ultrasound probe, which means it can fit in between rib spaces. It also gives a piece of pie or sector type picture on the ultrasound machine. It's the lowest frequency of all, and therefore gives a grainier picture that has the lower resolution, a greater depth that can look in quite well, but low frequency also does very good Doppler imaging, and that Doppler is all about movement and blood flow, hence we use it in cardiac imaging. And this particular probe runs between 1 and 3 megahertz. The final sort of probe I'm going to mention is the tight curvilinear probe, which is an intracavity probe, which we use for transvaginal ultrasound. It's got very high frequency because you're looking for ovaries and for endometrial abnormalities really close to the end of the probe, because you're actually transvaginal, you're right where you want to be for looking at the ovaries and for looking at the uterus. You get a very good resolution, but you can't look very far away. So high frequency again, good resolution, less depth. And we tend to use that for transvaginal scanning. There are all sorts of intracavity transducers. We tend to use this one. We can also use it for looking at Quinsey's and collections in the throat. So choosing the probe, with this particular ultrasound machine, when you press the probe button, it changes you from the curvilinear abdominal probe to the linear array to the echo probe. So just running through those again, each time you press the probe button, it takes you to whichever particular probe is attached to the machine. Other machines, the more transportable one I mentioned before, can come on a platform that you can wheel it around on, and you just press the button down here to change from the curvilinear abdominal probe to the linear array. But if you're on an aeroplane or you've got a backpack and your machine's in the backpack, you may have to actually unplug the probe to change and put in a new one. So you've got the patient right, you've got the probe right, and now you've got to choose the right preset. What do I mean by that? Each transducer can be used for a number of different things, and each transducer has its own factory-made custom presets. So the abdominal transducer, for example, can be set for aortic imaging or for obstetric imaging or for fast scan, and depending on what you set, the machine automatically optimizes the image for the scan type, and it optimizes what it thinks will be the depth that you want, the focal zones you want. It works out the dynamic range and the harmonics and the compound imaging that you want. You don't have to think about all that complicated stuff that people spend years at university learning about. The machine will choose it all for you to optimize for the sort of scan that you're going to do. And so here is one of those machines. We've plugged in the abdominal probe. You can click on OB for obstetric scanning, gynae scanning, abdominal scanning, or nerve scanning. Now, if you're using a curvilinear abdominal scan probe for nerves, it means that nerve must be a long way away, and it generally is epidural or sciatic or deep nerve blocks that people use if they're using this preset. But choose your preset, click on that, and the probe will be optimized for looking at whatever you want to be looking at. With our other machine, when you press on preset, it gives you a menu that goes through abdominal, cardiac, muscular, skeletal, obs and gynae, pediatric, small parts and vascular options. You click on one of those and it gives you a sub-menu, so you click on abdominal and then you can choose general, aortic, renal or pediatric. If you clicked on small parts, it would go to testes, thyroid, breast and a number of other options. So it's just really important that you choose the right preset. So patient, probe and preset, PPP. Now we're on to optimizing the image and onto the DFG, depth settings. Adjusting depth is really, really important in ultrasound. And what I suggest is when you're getting your picture, begin with a relatively deep setting. Find what you're looking for and then go superficial. Okay? Get what you're looking at in the middle of the screen. If you're looking too shallow, you're not going to see what you're looking at. If you're looking too deep, what you want to be looking at will be small and at the top of the screen. What you want is for what you're looking at to be in the middle of the screen and obvious. The machines, fortunately, have a button that says depth on it. Here's this one on this machine and this one on this one. Fairly easy, obviously. More superficial view, deeper view, more superficial view, and deeper view, not rocket science. So here is an image of the right upper quadrant. This is the skin at the top. Here is the curvilinear abdominal probe giving you your picture. This is the liver and diaphragm, lung above here, and this is the kidney. Now, if we're looking at the liver and kidney in this view, the depth setting is about right. On the right-hand side, these are centimeter marks, okay? And the big one is every 5 centimeters. So this is 0 at the top of the skin here, 5 centimeters, 10 centimeters, 15 centimeters, 17 centimeters away, the bottom of our image. And what we're looking at, our area of interest is in the middle. That's how you want your depth setting. But begin deep. This is what it looks like if you begin too shallow. That's exactly the same patient, same view, but my depth is too shallow. If you start too shallow, you can be completely lost. Here we go, we'll go a little bit deeper, a little bit deeper. Even here, you're not seeing what you want to see at the back of the kidney, the back of the liver. It's really important that you can actually see the back. So change your depth, now we're about right. If you go too deep, you're wasting all this space. Here, we don't need to be looking down here, and the view here isn't as good as it was. So don't go too deep. Here we go, start deep, go to where you want to be. That's the kidney, just going through that again. Start deep and change your depth until you're exactly where you want to be. The next view is of the aorta. Again, we'll start deep. Here's the aorta. And then go more and more and more superficial until we've got a nice view of that aorta and transverse section in the middle of our screen. So again, start deep, change your depth until you bring the aorta to where you want it to be. If you start too superficial, you may, in this view, actually just be looking, if the back of your picture was here, you might think this was the aorta, which is actually the superior mesenteric artery, and you might just view that if you had the wrong depth. So, I know I've said it a few times, but begin deep, go superficial. We're on to F for frequency selection. You understand already from what I've told you that high frequency gives you a high quality picture, high resolution, but poor penetration. You can't see very deep. Low frequency, lower resolution, it's a grainier picture, but you can see further. You should use the highest frequency that'll image acceptably at the depth that you're examining. Each probe, and when you've set your preset, has a range of frequencies at which it will operate. So each probe, let's go on here. So the abdominal probe, for example, I mentioned that it can range between 2 and 5 megahertz. You can set it if you've got a very big patient, to 2 megahertz. If you've got a pediatric patient or a thin patient, you can set it to 5 megahertz because you don't need to look as deeply, so you're choosing a higher frequency so you can see in better. Now, these machines, unfortunately, don't have, well, they do have a frequency button, but they don't call it frequency, unlike depth, which is straightforward. On this big machine, they call it fusion. And on the small machine, they don't actually call it anything. They call it gen. And these buttons change it. And in fact, on the small machine, when you press this button, it changes it from gen, which is general, and that's the mid-level frequency, to pen, which is low frequency and penetration, so looking deeper with a grainier picture, and then res, which is resolution, which is a fine picture, close up, not looking very deep, and a higher frequency. So that abdominal probe would go from 2 megahertz at the pen to 3.5 at the gen to 5 at the res setting. This particular machine has a fusion. It doesn't actually go from 2 to 3.5 to 5. It uses a number of different frequencies, but most of them are at the top end of that range or at the bottom end of that range, depending on what you want to be at. And here you can see most of them are at the 5 end, most of the frequencies. Here they're in the middle, and here they're at the lower end. So again, adjust your frequency. Generally, the preset will organize the frequency right, and the mid-range is fine. But if for some reason you think, I really want a good picture here and I've got a thin patient, it's not far away what I want to see, move it up to a higher frequency. If it's a big patient, things are further away and you're just not getting a good image, change to a lower frequency. So patient, probe, preset, depth, frequency. Focus is the next F. And most machines have an adjustable focal zone. And the focal zone is the point that the ultrasound beam is narrowest, and it's the point that you get the best picture. You can imagine a focal zone. The ultrasound beam is actually shaped like this, and then the picture is best just in the middle where the beam is narrowest. And you should move the focal zone to the point of interest. Now, on the right-hand side of the image by tradition is a little arrow or a triangle or some little shape, and that is what determines where the focal zone is. So in this image, the focal zone would be here. Now, if I'm wanting to look at this little bit of the patient, it's a sensible place for the focal zone to be. If I'm actually wanting to look at the liver edge up here, I should move the focal zone up here. And in fact, I should change my depth, so I am just looking here, if that's what I'm focusing on. Fortunately, here on this machine, a button that says focus, up and down, and that will move the focus up and down. And you can see here, this is that aortic view, I'm moving the focal zone up and down, which improves the picture at different levels. The simple small machines often don't have an adjustable focal zone. The aim is to be intuitive. They say, well look, the person's going to put what they want to see in the middle of the screen, let's make that the right focal zone. And they often have more than one focal zone. So this image is of the Achilles. It's a longitudinal section. This is the patient's head end up this end. This is the Achilles tendon. This is the skin here. Achilles tendon, and this is the calcaneum. And you can see for this image, there are actually 4 focal zones. So 4 ultrasound beams are being sent down any single line of sight to make this image. It makes a much better picture that way. But it takes longer to make the picture. So if a patient is still and the frame rate isn't important, it's a nice thing to be able to have lots of focal zones. But generally with abdominal imaging, we don't have multifocal zones. We're on to gain now. In all machines, you can adjust the overall gain. And gain is the brightness of the entire image. It's kind of like volume control on a stereo, but it's not volume, it's brightness. And the aim is for fluid to look black. And almost any image you take, there'll be little bits of fluid. Try and get those things to look black by adjusting the gain just right. It's also important you have a couple of bright white areas of high echogenicity. But you really want a range. You want most of the image to be shades of grey. Just a couple of things black and a couple of things white. A lot of machines have an auto gain button, which you can just press and it tries to set the gain right for you. It's useful, but it's not perfect. So you really do need to be able to adjust the gain. Again, I'm going to go to our complex and our simple machine. Each machine has a gain button. This is the gain button on our big machine and the gain button on the small machine. They say gain, again useful. And if you dial them clockwise, the picture gets brighter, and if you dial them anti-clockwise, it gets darker. But it's more complex than that. Sometimes you want to adjust the brightness at the top of the image, and sometimes at the bottom of the image. On the simple machine, this button here, it says near above it, controls the brightness at the top of the image, the top half of the image, so you can make the top half duller or brighter. And this one, it says far above it, controls the brightness at the bottom of the screen, at the bottom of the image, further away, and you can make it again duller or brighter as you want. So this one, overall gain, this one, gain on the bottom half of the screen, and this one, gain on the top half. On the big machine, we have these slide controls. This one controls the very top of the image, this one almost the top, these ones the middle, and these ones the bottom, and you can individually adjust these to get the gain just right. So here is a picture of that right upper quadrant. The near gain, or the top half of the gain slide rule, I'm changing. What you want though is for some things to be black, these blood vessels, hepatic veins, black, and some things to be bright white. Here, the lung, and this little bit where the kidney is, the cortex or the capsule of the kidney is bright white. So this gain's about right. Some things black, some things white, but most in between. Here I'm adjusting the gain in the middle of the ultrasound probe first, and obviously wrongly, and then in the far zone. But you want it to get it all nice and right. Here, some things black, a couple of things white, but most grey. If you get it wrong, these medullary pyramids, which are a dark grey, may look black and you might actually think they're cysts. So it is really important that you get your gain just right. Here's the bladder. We're adjusting gain in the far field so we can see those seminal vesicles nicely. We can see the prostate rather than it just looking a bright white, horrible look, which it looked at initially. Bright white, couldn't tell what's going on down there. Looks like there's stuff hanging around in the bladder, but actually that's just gain, it's artifact. Now it's right. Urine is black. Couple of white things, that's what you want. So, going through it again. Patient, probe, preset, depth, focus, frequency, and gain. All right, we're on to the next section of the lecture, which is about recording images optimally. It quite often happens that you're imaging a patient and it's a really difficult scan, and you get the perfect view, you move, you press the freeze button, and you look back at your image and you've missed it, you've moved. Well, all the machines have a scroll feature where it records the last 3 seconds or so of imaging, and you can scroll back to look to catch that perfect image that you had in the last few seconds. You can also make measurements and calculations. You can label your image, and you should save and print your images. On the big machine, this is the scroll bar. So you press freeze, which is down here, when you want to catch your image. If you just miss it, you just roll this little ball back and it'll take you back through the cine loop so you can find the perfect image, which then you can save. On the smallest, more simple machine, you just press freeze and then you just rub your finger one way or the other way on the mouse pad to scroll through the cine loop to find your perfect image. So freeze and scroll, that's pretty easy. We've gone through that already. Measuring is always important, particularly if you're measuring aortas or kidneys or foreign bodies or whatever it is. What you do is you freeze your image, scroll back to the perfect bit, then you press the caliper button, and what generally happens is you get a small X appearing on the image, which you can move with the rollerball or mouse pad to where you want. You then press the select button, and a second X appears on the screen. You move that to where you want it, and the exact distance between the two calipers is shown on the screen. Much easier to explain that. You press the caliper button, and there's the select button. On this one, a caliper button and a select button, and here is an example done on an old machine, but this is that right upper quadrant again, mine again. We've frozen the image, now you press caliper, you move, this little X comes down to where you want it to go, you press select, you move, and the other one to the other end of the kidney, you press select, and 11.5 centimeters is the length of that kidney. I'm just labeling it right upper quadrant. So measuring, not a big deal, but important. Here again, we've measured that kidney and the top left, 11.5 centimeters. Most machines have calculations packages. They're quite useful and they depend on the probe used and your preset. And if you make a number of measurements, the machine will perform calculations. So for example, if you measure, you take an image of the bladder in transverse and longitudinal and you measure the bladder in the X, Y, and Z planes, the machine will calculate the volume in the bladder. Similarly, if you're using an early pregnancy preset and you make a measurement and tell the machine that that's the crown rump length, it will tell you what gestation that pregnancy is at. So calculation packages are useful and you may need to come to them as you get more advanced in your scanning. Again, not rocket science. There's a button that says calc on the big fancy machines or the less fancy, more robust machines. Once you've got your perfect image, it's really important to label it right. Having put all that effort in, you really need to make people know what you're looking at. And you can label using text. And to do that, I always say the organ, the region, or the view. So if I'm looking at the aorta, I'll write aorta. But sometimes you're looking at a region. You're looking at the right upper quadrant. You're not actually looking at the liver or Morrison's pouch or the kidney. You're just looking in that area. So there I put RUQ or right upper quadrant or parasternal for a cardiac view. So it doesn't really matter what you write as long as it makes it quite clear what you're looking at. But as well as the region of the body you're looking at, the orientation of the probe is important in interpreting the image. And the most common two terms that people use are LS for a longitudinal view, which is generally with a probe in the long axis of the body, or a transverse view, or TS for transverse, where the probe is transverse across the body. Long axis usually means you're in the long axis of an organ, so a gallbladder, which may be oblique to the body, the long axis is the long view, and the short axis is the short view across it. As well as text, you can label using body image markers, and that's a nice alternative to labeling. It's a bit time-consuming, but it does give visual information about where the probe is and which way it's oriented. So let's have a look. This is an ultrasound image of something that you probably wouldn't have a clue what it is unless it was appropriately labeled. So if I now put large bowel, I know what we're looking at, and epigastrium TS. So this means the probe is in the epigastrium and it's transversely, and I'm looking at large bowel. Now you still might not know exactly what it is that we're looking at. So you can label as much as you want. There's no rules about this. Try this. Here we've got subcutaneous tissue, rectus and rectus. So these are the two rectus sheaths in cross-section. This is the linear in the middle, linear alba. Then we've got bowel wall, fecal material, and large bowel. So suddenly, with the probe transversely in the epigastrium, we now know what we're looking at just by putting labels on. So labels are useful. You can also record a clip, and this is a clip of the same thing. You can see it's pulsatile because the aorta is just below it, and here the bowel is peristalsing. You can see fecal material moving along. So often, labeling and saving a clip can be very useful ways of making it quite clear what you're looking at. The little body image marker, here it is. Body image, probe in the transverse position in the epigastrium, and this the transverse colon. So sometimes a combination of the little body image marker and text is a very useful way of labeling images. But it's essential that you label your image, what it is, and the orientation of the probe. Saving and printing is important as well. You need to save images, important positive and negative images, If it's a normal aorta, not an aneurysmal one, it's just as important as if it is aneurysmal. I generally try and keep the images with the report and consider saving a clip, as we've already mentioned. The next section of this lecture is using the transducer, and we go through getting the image and then exploring an organ. We're going to touch on the orientation of the transducer, the importance of using a lot of gel, how to hold the ultrasound transducer, getting an image, starting with big, bold movements, trying to find the acoustic window, and then using small, refined movements and adjustments to perfect that image, and then getting the patient to help you if you really need to optimize things. Now, orientation, just like the driving the car analysis earlier on, is very important. In the transverse view, and here I am with the probe transversely across the patient's abdomen, the right of the patient is the left of the screen, and it all matches up. Now, that doesn't make much sense until you look at it like this. It's really important that the right-hand side of the patient, so this side, is the left-hand side of the screen. So this side of the screen is this side of the patient. It matches up, okay? As soon as you turn your ultrasound probe around 180 degrees, it's exactly the same process for doing the scan, but then this side of the patient will actually be this side of the image. And when you move the probe this way, it'll actually move that way on the screen, and everything gets much more confusing. So it's really important, once again, this side of the patient, this side of the image. This side of the patient, this side of the image. Whichever particular way you're looking at, whether you're looking standing in the traditional place or you're opposite the ultrasound machine, again, this side of the transducer is this side of the image, and this side is this side. And that's particularly important if you're going to be putting a needle in here. You must make sure that it actually comes in here if you're putting it in here. If you try and put it in here and it actually comes in this side, it's chaos, I can tell you, having done it. So how do you tell which way is which? Well, I tend to hold the probe up in front of the machine, put a little dollop of gel on. Straight away, you can see that where this gel is, here is a white line on the machine, and that's how you should put the patient transversely onto the patient's belly. Another way, oh, here it is again, little dollop of gel on, and then you know that this side of the transducer is this side of the image, and you'll just put it straight onto the patient like that. Another way is just to rub one end of the probe, and now you're rubbing one end of the probe here, and you can see the left-hand side is the right-hand side. We turn the probe around, and suddenly it matches. This side of the probe, this side of the image, I'll put the transducer onto the patient's abdomen transversely like that. This is a picture of a ureteric jet. You can imagine this is the bladder, and this is urine squirting out of the patient's left ureter. You can imagine the patient lying there. You're looking for an obstructed ureter that doesn't have a jet on one side. It's really important that you know that this side of the patient, or this side of the picture, is this side of the patient whose head end is up here and feet are down there. So the right-hand side of this is the left-hand side of a supine patient. Make sure it all matches up. Sounds confusing, but it's not. As long as you know which side is which, it's easy. In longitudinal, the convention is to have the head of the patient at the left of the screen. Let me show you here. Now, by convention, this side of the screen is the head end of the patient. When you've got the probe in the longitudinal orientation here, this side of the screen always is the head end of the patient, and this side of the screen is the foot end of the patient. And that's by convention. So here we have that kidney view again. It's a longitudinal kidney view. We know then that this must be the head end of the patient, and this must be the foot end of the patient, and it's always the same. Here's the diaphragm then, here's the liver, here's the upper pole of the kidney and the lower pole of the kidney, and so is here. So foot end, head end, always the same. Whether you're looking at an Achilles in longitudinal or a kidney in longitudinal, that's the same. So here we are in transverse, and we rotate the probe to longitudinal, and you really only ever need to go from transverse to longitudinal. It's quite easy. You never have to get awkward as soon as you're over on that side, things are awkward. So transverse, longitudinal, transverse, longitudinal. That's all, the only movements you need to make with a probe. How to hold the transducer and getting the best image. It's important you use lots of gel. Air is our enemy in ultrasound. Air and bone you can't see through. And if there's air between the transducer face or the footprint of the probe and the patient's skin, you're not going to see anything. So put on lots of gel. Then I tend to hold the transducer like a big pen. And you can see me here holding it as I would as if this was a big pen. But I also have to, I also touch the patient. You rest your fingers on the patient. That gives you finer control. And you can also determine how hard you're pressing the probe. It's really important that you actually touch the patient to get a good picture. Here I am in longitudinal, looking at Achilles, and again, my fingers here are touching the patient. I know how hard I'm pressing, and I can control my movements of the probe very finely and easily, rather than if I'm freehand. Okay. Now, finding the acoustic window is really important. Every patient is different. I've mentioned that the enemies of ultrasound are gas and bone. And in this here, we're looking at the right upper quadrant. There's a lot of bone in the way, and there's a lot of gas. Now, there's gas in the lung, there's gas in the bowel. All these ribs are in the way. We've got to find the best view to look through the back of the patient to look at this kidney. So I begin with making big, bold movements. And I think James just here starts off doing big movements. Look there, no, not seeing anything. Look there, not seeing anything. Look, see, nothing. Oh, and then once you find something, then start making fine movements and optimize your image. So you start by making big movements, and then when you find your image, little movements. Here we go again, big, bold movements, trying to find an acoustic window through the bone and through the bowel and through the lung, and here is the spot, then fine adjustments to get the picture optimized. This is a transverse slide, and one of the ways we move the ultrasound probe, there are different big movements you can do, that, the transverse slide, looking, in this case, for the aorta. Because there are lots of bowel gas between the aorta and the skin, and you have to find a glimpse of the aorta somewhere between epigastrium and umbilicus. So here is that ultrasound going from the epigastrium to the umbilicus, all the way from top to bottom. A nice, quick, big, bold movement. So we start again at the epigastrium, and here is the aorta as we go down, 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 and then we lose it right at the bottom before it bifurcates under bowel. Start again, transverse slide, here we go, epigastrium, aorta, down we go, down, 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 seeing it all the way. Somewhere in there we can see it perfectly, and in fact it's just before it disappears, and that's where you'd optimize your image. So that's called the transverse slide. It's one of the big, bold movements you can do. The longitudinal slide, another big, bold movement. Searching for the right acoustic window. This is the longitudinal slide, the head end of the patient here, the liver here, we're going down, these are lumbar vertebrae here, longitudinal view of the aorta as we go down, down, down to that liver. Okay, we'll try that again. Longitudinal slide, diaphragm, head end, aorta there, longitudinal, down, 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 there's the duodenum, down. So, transverse side, longitudinal slide. Once you find the good acoustic window, then the small refined adjustments. And the movements that you can make then are fanning the probe, rotating the probe, and tilting the probe. So we've got slide, transverse and longitudinal, to find the acoustic window. And then the fine adjustments, fan, rotate, and tilt. Let's go through those. This is fanning, okay? Let's say he's found the perfect spot to look at the aorta, and he fans one way and the other through it. Here it is. Here's the aorta longitudinal, fanning to the left, fanning to the right, back to the middle. That's the spot that you want, okay? But fan through the organ, left to right. Tilt. Look up towards the heart, look down towards the feet. That's the tilt. Heel toe, some people call it. Here we go. We're going to go down towards the feet first. This is the feet end. And then up towards the heart. And there, here you have diaphragm and heart beating away here, tilting. Really nice picture. We'll go through that again. Tilting here is aorta, tilting down. Bowel gas, feet, liver here, tilting up again, diaphragm and heart, we're looking up. But all keeping the footprint of the ultrasound probe in the same place, tilting down, tilting up, or heel toe, as they call it. Next is rotate, transverse to longitudinal. Quite easy there. Transverse to longitudinal. The key when you're doing this is keeping what you're looking at in the middle of the screen, and here we go. From transverse to longitudinal. We've rotated from the transverse position to the longitudinal, and now we're going to go back from longitudinal to transverse. So we've got slide, transverse and longitudinal, fan, tilt, and rotate. The last thing you can do to improve the image is to get the patient to help. So you've really nearly got a good window. Sometimes getting the patient to take a deep breath can help because it moves all the intra-abdominal organs down and you might catch a glimpse of what you need perfectly. You might get them to raise an arm or roll onto their side or stand up. Each of these things can help in optimizing an image, and it depends on the clinical scenario, obviously, as to what's appropriate. Getting the best images and how to explore an organ is the next thing that we're going to look at. When you're examining anything with ultrasound and you've found the area of interest, it's really important that you explore that organ in two planes. So you can imagine I've got something that I'm ultrasounding here. What I tend to do is I fan through it one way in one plane, think about making any measurements, calculations using Doppler, whatever I want to do, but I fan through it that way, then I turn my probe and I fan through it this way. So, and that goes for whatever you're ultrasounding, whether it's the heart or the bladder or an eyeball or a testicle or whatever, a liver metastasis, we look at everything in two planes, one way and then the other way, okay? Let's look at this kidney. This is the transverse view of the liver. I'm going down from top to bottom, and this is the kidney as it comes into view, okay? I'm going right from the top right to the bottom. I've gone right through that kidney there. I know that I haven't missed anything. So here we go again, the liver. I go down, here's the top of the kidney through there, the vessels and coming off, down through the bottom of the kidney, this is the psoas here. But we've gone right through that kidney, right from top to bottom in transverse plane. Then we go from side to side, fanning from one side to the other side of the kidney. That's lateral. Then we go through medial of the kidney. We'll go through that again. Here we go, medial first. Here are the vessels coming off. Then laterally, right through the kidney. We know that we haven't missed anything. We've looked at it in two planes. And that's really important. Whatever you're looking at, try and fan through it in two planes. You'll be pleased to know we're almost there. The next section is completing the scan, and we'll touch on writing a report and looking after the machine. Writing a report is really important. It's how we communicate with people, and the type of report depends on your expertise. In the initial modular course, we try and encourage people to use basic pre-formatted reports. Once you are an expert, you can write more advanced reports and are given much more scope. But this is an example of an emergency aortic ultrasound, and it's a pro forma report. If you fill this in, everyone will know what you're doing, and communication is easy. So with this particular report, and we've got lots of these for different things that people are ultrasounding, emergency aorta, this is a focused abdominal aortic ultrasound. It aims to determine the diameter of the abdominal aorta. Generally, it cannot confirm or exclude rupture or any other pathology. Any incidental findings commented on should be independently confirmed by formal imaging investigation. So there we go, that's the lawyers talking. But basically, you're saying, all I'm looking at is how big the abdominal aorta is. Nothing else. Okay. Then, we've got a picture of the aorta here. which if you want, you can sketch findings on. So if you've got a little aneurysm here, you could draw it on here, but you don't have to, because the aim of this is just to tell you how big the aorta is. These are different images, and it's just an aid memoir for people using this. But the basic report, abdominal aorta, transverse, normal, you can just circle that. Inadequate views, circle that. Or transverse maximal diameter, 6 centimeters. So let's say you're doing an aortic scan, you see there's a 6 centimeter aneurysm, you can just write 6 there. The abdominal aorta longitudinal view, normal, circle that. Inadequate views, circle that. Or 6 centimeters in longitudinal section. So really, to fill this in, all we have to write is history, query AAA, collapse, back pain, you know, pulse 110, BP 80, 6 centimeters, conclusion, abdominal aortic aneurysm, 6 centimeters, done. If you want, you can put down some evidence of rupture. Is there a retroperitoneal hematoma? No. Inadequate views to be sure, or yes. Is there free fluid? No, not sure, or a small amount, a moderate amount, or a large amount. And then a conclusion, which is always important. Emergency aortic ultrasound findings must be consistent with clinical suspicion. Integrate history, examination, investigations, and findings to reach a conclusion. Seek formal ultrasound or CT if uncertainty remains. So you can write your little conclusion here. And generally, it just says a synopsis of what you found, like 6 centimeter abdominal aortic aneurysm. This is really just to help communication. I've had residents who've watched me do an aortic ultrasound and then written normal abdominal ultrasound. Obviously, completely different. A patient who I've excluded a AAA on has in fact got a hydronephrosis and a renal obstruction, for example, which I didn't see because all I was doing was looking at the aorta. We've communicated completely wrongly and everything's gone off track. So I really encourage you to use these pre-formatted reports, or at least communicate with the patient and other doctors and write in the notes clearly what you're doing, just looking at the size of the aorta. And here, size of the aorta, normal or abnormal, views inadequate or adequate. And that's how it works. So that's the report. Obviously, you need to put your name and sign them and date them at the bottom as well. And these are designed to fit into the patient notes, and you're welcome to print them out. They'll be on our website. If you've got more experience, you can write an advanced report. But generally, the format is similar. You write a little bit about the history, the requested scan, your findings, including important positives and negatives. And you can include clinical findings during the scan. It's really important. If the gallbladder had stones and the wall was a bit thick and it was really tender when you pushed on it, it's much more likely to be cholecystitis than if it wasn't tender at all. Then you write your conclusions and you name your date. Pretty much the same thing. And the final part is looking after the ultrasound machine. When you finish doing a study, it's important you close that study. Because it can, if the machine's turned on with an open study, it can sometimes mess the machine up. They're expensive machines and they need tender, loving care. If you're going to leave the machine on, which is generally fine, try and freeze the image. The reason is that you're constantly vibrating those little crystals in the ultrasound transducer if the image isn't frozen, and it will eventually wear out. So freezing the image just lets the probe relax and makes it last longer. Turn off the machine if you're not going to use it for a while. Make sure you know how to stock up on new gel and paper. That tends to be the most irritating thing where I work. Clean the transducer and generally follow what the manufacturer recommends. Rinsing the transducer under cold water seems to work just fine. But there are always manufacturers' recommendations that should be followed. The final important thing is to look after the transducers and the cords. The transducers are really expensive and really fragile, generally. And the cords are long enough for us to do scans with, which means that they generally lie on the ground and it's so easy to get wheeled over and so easy to get damaged. So be careful with them. That's the end of the lecture. I hope it was useful, and we'll see you on the course.